Good evening and welcome. I'm your host, Mary Davis, and you all know what this show is, the Mary Davis Show, and we have a great lineup for you today. Have one successful school board candidate who is here, another successful Erie County legislature who is here, and a successful activist who is here in civil rights, and of course we have a person who is a columnist for one of the local newspapers.
I'm not successful, I guess. Is that what you're saying, Mary?
No, okay. No, of course I'm not saying that. Frank Gibson, we know that he's been writing his column for a while. Is that right? And we know that he is successful. He's been doing it a while, so they must love his success because he's still there, even though it's a like family-owned kind of thing. And I think these other ladies probably own what they're doing, too. I think that Betty Jean owns the Erie County, the second district in Erie County legislature. Yes. I think that's got her name on it. She's like, you're going to be there forever.
Not really, but for a while.
But for a while.
Yes.
But we're talking about this evening, we're going to talk about some things we have talked about. Locally, Carl Palladino's majority got a butt whooping. That's all I can say about that. Will Carl now take the hint and leave the Board of Education? You need to stay tuned to find out about that. And we're going to move on to the state. New Jersey used to be the land of crooked politicians. Move over, Jersey. Now it's New York, as we find that I don't know how many New York State politicians either on their way to jail or the sheriff is right behind them. And then choosing a president in 2016. Well, that's still the hottest thing going. So we're going to get to that, too. So we're going to try to cover three issues here where we go. An 18-year-old Hutch Tech High School senior nearly sent Palladino packing. Palladino is reported to be planning on leaving the Board of Education, and I don't think nobody will be very unhappy to see him go. And he's doing that in order to once again run for governor of New York. The list of New York State politicians either in jail or one step ahead of the sheriff is growing. G. Stephen Pigeon comes to mind. I hope we get to have a few things to say about him. Donald Trump, a frequent guest on the Howard Stern show, has quite a potty mouth. His view on women are disgusting. Just be sure your kids aren't listening. Now, Trump was also good at playing his own spokesman. I guess we've all heard about that by now. And that was kind of funny in a way. In the late 90s, he was known as John Miller, Trump's spokesman during his divorce from his first wife. Trump has also punked his former girlfriends, but he is still now trying to punk the nation. His former butler has threatened to hang President Obama from the White House. He calls the White House the White Mosque porch. Trump also says that he works very hard to pay as little taxes as he can, and that his tax returns are none of voters' business. What could his taxes tell voters about his dealings? That he hides money offshore? That he consorts with mobsters and traffickers? And what he really, what he really gives to charity. You know, I often wonder what Donald Trump actually gives to charity. I believe it's probably as much as all of us give when we go and put in $5 or $10 to whatever organization or charity we're trying to do. A lot of right-wing racist seems to be among Trump's followers. Lest we forget, Trump was the father of the birther movement when he tried to delegitimate President Obama. You know, he labeled his opponents Lying Ted and Crooked Hillary. Will his Teflon covering wear off in the general? You know, stay tuned to this too. And also check out the Mary Davis Show on www.themarydavisshow.com. And beginning that, I guess we'll begin locally. Should we have the candidates who won her election start first? Ms. Paulette Woods.
Hi, Mary. I just wanted to say thank you to everyone who voted for me. Thank you to the community. Thank you to everyone who carried my petitions. Thank you for everybody who trusted me with this responsibility. There is no power like the power of the people. And I just want to say to God be the glory, because so many churches work for me. The Women Warriors work for me. My family, my dad covered a polling place for me. It was just a community movement for people who really care about the children. And I promise to work very hard, we already started, to make the future brighter for our children.
Thank you for that. Frank, we'll go to you since you're a lone male on the panel tonight. What do you got to say about local issues?
About what, Mary? The school board? Congratulations, Paulette. I do have a question for you now. You weren't actually raised in the city of Buffalo. You went to school in Angola, right? And I just wanted to show as a testament to what a good educational system will bring. Because I know your sisters were very awesome, very successful. And, you know, when you look back, it was probably because you got a good fundamental education in Angola.
Actually, I went to school in Lackawanna.
Oh, Lackawanna. Oh,
in grammar school in Lackawanna.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And my parents said the most important thing you had to do was to get an education. Yeah. And when we moved to farmland in Angola, I had to work on the fields with the migrants, picking strawberries, string beans, and cutting grapes to help pay the taxes to keep a roof over our head. Yeah. So I'm just saying, no matter where you come from, how poor you are with 14 kids, a good education will make a difference.
There was 14 of you? That's a big family.
Yeah.
14
of us. I always thought you were raised in Angola.
I went to high school in Angola.
Oh, did you? Okay, yeah.
That's what you get for thinking, Frank.
Yeah. I mean, it just goes to show when you get a good fundamental education that, you know, it carries through you throughout life. And I was, you know, that's my point. That's the only point.
Well, Betty Jean, seems like you and Paulette sort of share a kindred thing here. You've often spoke on this program as well as others that you often did some farm work.
Yeah, I did a lot of farm work, and I did pick cotton. I did pick cotton. In fact, pick cotton, dug up sweet potatoes, pick grapes, anything that was edible and that could be eaten and would supplement the nutrition of our family, you know, because we had 16 our families. My mother had 16 children. Yes. Okay. There was a space between maybe 23 years between the oldest and the youngest. But
where did you fit in that number? Were you kind of toward the middle,
fifth,
the younger?
The fifth born, but the third oldest that survived. Two died in infancy that she had had. So I'm the third oldest that's still alive.
Oh, wow.
I'm the third oldest also. Mm.
That is
nice. Between the two of y'all, you got a community.
Yeah. We
a relative.
Yes, that's a big fan. What about you, Joan? Tell us what's on your mind locally.
I'm looking forward to a change in priorities for the school board. And I'm looking forward to putting the children first, less rhetoric, more reality.
Mm-hmm. Will that be something else?
I want to say one thing. I'm so disappointed when they talk about the election and the former minority now in majority, and they said that is because the union bought. I think very few
from the Buffalo
unions can go out there and buy, because the union of people and those people who voted, if the members live in that geographical district of that school board member, then that person has a right to vote. Mm-hmm. And I can't see, because you're not being supported by big business and you're endorsed by the union. It doesn't say you're controlled by the union, nor does it say that you are bought
you
by the union.
Buffalo News?
No, it's just a lot of conversation out there, you know, their union bought and paid. The Buffalo News put
it's
much on BTF
yeah,
and NYSUC endorsement,
sure.
But they said nothing about the Samson people who were the opponent.
Mm-hmm.
They're supported by the Greater Buffalo Niagara Partnership,
mm-hmm.
and those are the ones who supported a lot of the charter schools being in place. So it seemed that I never saw such biased reporting that was done this cycle for the Buffalo News I've seen my whole life. They was like they had a personal agenda of not having anybody who to be elected who are not under the leadership of the Buffalo Niagara Partnership. I never saw that before in my life. It was editorializing every day. They were talking about discrediting those candidates who might were supported by the BTF. Mm-hmm. And I don't know what the news investment
was. It just comes down to they don't think black people have enough independent minded to do such things like this on their own. Mm-hmm. So they figure somebody must be behind it. So it must be the union that's really
too,
pushing,
they're
you know.
Right.
You know, that's what it really comes down to, is that black people can't have their own agenda, you know.
It's terrible.
Well, you know, just several weeks ago, Commissioner Aaliyah met in the city of Buffalo on a mansion on Delaware Avenue with business leaders in the community, in the city of Buffalo, and a select few members of the school board. Superintendent Cash was there, Larry Quinn was there, and James Sampson. And
Who else?
That's who they picked. Mm-hmm. That's who they picked. The problem is that the people that back the Buffalo News and the people that are so-called running this reform agenda,
so-called,
let me tell you,
right.
They are the people that understand that until they improve the education system, they're not going to be able to attract people to occupy these luxury condominiums mm-hmm. and lofts that they're building in the city of Buffalo. You know, if the status of the school system has been deteriorating for decades, but now they want to attract all this money, and that's the reason why you've got all the business leaders now. That's why they want the Palladinos and the Quinns and McCarthy's on the board.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's what I was mentioning, the fact that that's who they seem to have invited to this meeting. I didn't hear a name mentioned of the former minority.
No, of course
right.
not.
You know, I didn't hear any, or even some people who may even have been considered neutral in these in this type
right.
of high-powered meeting.
And also, Mary, you see a desperation news. I never seen anybody who didn't have the fortitude to make the ballot, who cannot get knocked off the ballot to be endorsed by the Buffalo News. When you run for a position and you don't have enough qualifying signature, you're off the ballot, you're just like anybody else. Anybody can be a write-in candidate.
Mm-hmm.
But yet the news endorsed two write-in candidates
yes.
that had no legitimacy to be considered because they did not make the ballot, so therefore they was out of the pot. And when we had a school board's interview of the candidates, some of these non-candidates were invited to the forum.
Mm-hmm.
I'm saying, you know, anybody can be a write-in candidate. I could have gone to that polling place, wrote my name in, I'm a write-in candidate.
Mm-hmm.
But yet the Buffalo News saw fit to endorse two people who did not make the ballot and one person who didn't even ask for the endorsement. Carpell didn't ever ask for the news endorsement, but they endorsed them anyway. So
which is going to show you where they are.
It was like a last effort of desperation on their part to say, we want these people, and by hook or crook, we're going to get them in. But fortunately for us, the voters were more informed, and they didn't fall for that. And I just think this was crazy. The president race was election was strange. The school board race, that was strange as well. All the people who had a vested interest that don't live in the particular district, that they have no children going to Buffalo Public Schools, but yet and still they tried to co-opt that election. And then they blame it on the unions when they were just as guilty or more guilty
yes,
because
absolutely.
They show a preference. They show a clear preference that they want these particular people in. If these people didn't get in, all hell's going to break loose. It didn't break loose. You know,
the sky didn't fall in.
And
it's because they're
Buffalo News has always been intricately involved with school board elections or for whatever reasons. I know when I ran for the school board back in 93,
mm-hmm.
I did an interview before the Buffalo News, and this guy excoriated me. I mean, mm-hmm. because basically my platform was I thought we were wasting money on busing.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was basically a big scam, but that's another story.
Mm-hmm.
But they excoriated me to go out of their way. Mm-hmm. You know, that I wasn't conforming to what they thought should be best for their children, you know,
right.
for whoever children, you know, but they're intricately involved with it.
Mm-hmm. And they're very anti-union. What happened to you, Paulette? Did you interview in front of them?
I interviewed in front of them, and they tried so hard to steer me into, well, which faction are you going
right.
to be
mm-hmm.
with?
Mm-hmm.
And they got infuriated because I said, I'm not here to be in factions. I'm here to represent the best interests of the children. Mm-hmm. Well, are you with the minority or majority? And I'm telling them, I am for smaller class sizes. Mm-hmm. I am for community schools. Mm-hmm. I am for empowering these parents to be able to get their children to school. And all they're saying is minority or majority. And I'm saying, I'm going to work with everyone. Mm-hmm. I'll work with anybody to help the kids.
That's a position that the Buffalo News is continually trying to play on the divisiveness mm-hmm. on the board. And
they were for the majority. They were for the
And the other one, the other thing is, I hate the word reform. They want to transform, not reform. Mm-hmm. Their idea of transformation is dismantle public education. All the effort and money that they're spending negatively against public schools, they should be spending trying to improve them, but they're fostering that divisiveness because it makes good press. They're also saying that the minority members of the board want the status quo. Well, first of all, I think it's ridiculous to even say that anybody on that board, even Palladino, intentionally wants our children to fail. Their motivation for being there is different. But well, I don't think anybody really wants them, any of the kids, to fail.
Well, I know that as far as I could read in the news, on the editorial page, that is, I don't think they had a nice thing to say about any person who was not following the agenda of the majority. I don't think they did.
No.
Former
majority?
Former majority. Mm-hmm.
Well, they definitely attacked.
Me personally, I'm not really mad at the former majority because it seems to me they shook up that board and made people realize that, hey, education wasn't getting done and we're going to try to do something about it. Now, whether or not charter schools work or don't work, nobody seems to have the statistics on that. But I wish what are the statistics? And what are charter schools outperforming?
They're not performing. They're not doing what they said they was going to.
Exactly. There's no empirical data. Right. Exactly.
Charter schools.
All I know as a parent who put my kids in through private, I wish I had that option at the time to send them, because my children went to public schools and I saw how a lot of these teachers performed. And you can't say that my child didn't come from a background of, a screwed up background. I know for sure that's not true in my case. Mm-hmm. You know, so I wish that option was available. I mean, we could talk about this rhetoric, but the fact of the matter is the schools were failing and still failing, and something has to be done. And the status quo of failing, somebody needs to do something.
But the change of failing school, you have to look at what the children want. You have to put more technical and vocational schools. You have to give a child a reason to come to school. After 12 years, if they're not going to come out with a job, a skill, a trade, job ready, career ready, or college ready,
if they get that in a charter school, then
they're not necessarily getting it in a charter school.
Something has come from the background. My kids went to Buffalo Public School. They went to Campus East, School 78, East High, Bennett High School, and Performing Arts. They all graduated with a region exam. They all graduated top 10 of their classes. Why? Because I was there as a parent, reinforced with what they got at home. When they came home at afternoon, where's your homework? You do your homework first, and you play later. And so there was expectation for me, and plus they are competitors, so there was their need to be at the top of their classes. So when you say fail in school, school can't fail, building can't fail. Mm-hmm. What has failed, either teacher, that student, or that parent? And sometimes combination of all three. And you can't have good schools without having good parents. You can't have good student without having good parents. And you can't have good teachers without the
parent involvement.
Involved and that teacher, make sure the teacher does her job. Because I'm telling you, I didn't leave my children's education to the school. I taught them at home and when school was reinforced. And so, make a long story short, if we have parents who send their children to school and don't ask them about homework, don't ask them about what he's learning, don't take him to broaden his experience while he's at home during the summer, take him to the museum. We got kids in Buffalo never attended Science Museum. We got children who never attended Buffalo Zoo. And that's these things are practically free, so we had to make an investment in our children, and it begins at home.
And the schools have to teach to the whole child.
It's not really my issue. I mean, that's not really my issue. My issue is that on a whole, what you said stated in your campaign, how many people graduate from high school, don't graduate from high school in your own campaign?
Have any of you guys factored in the fact about poverty that factors in here?
They have a 61% graduation rate.
Or the parents are working two and three jobs, which is kind of hard. It's kind of hard to attend PTA meetings and everything else if the mother is working full time in the morning and she's gone when the kids are, or she's got to run to a second job in the afternoon. Maybe she's the only one working the family. You know, sometimes you have to make these decisions, and it is kind of rough. I think that perhaps there should be maybe more programs and things to help people out that's doing these things. I don't think any parent really deliberately wants their kid to fail.
Yeah,
but sometimes you have to make a decision. Do they eat?
Mm-hmm.
Do they have a roof over their head? Or do something else takes place? And these are hard decisions a lot of times for any parent to make.
Well, that's
and I know that because I was kind of a latchkey kid.
Right.
I found out when I was there. My mother worked usually in the afternoon all the time, and I was in one foster home after another, usually. And it can be kind of hard. And not because anybody wanted to, but because these decisions had to be made. What do I have to do first? I have to keep a roof over the head. I have to feed them. Mm-hmm. And those are your priorities. Sometimes I think there needs to be programs and things to help parents in these situations.
And that's why this is an exciting time to be part of the school board, because we have programs like community schools, which are going to have after-school programs for the children, so mom can have the kid not be a latchkey kid, he can be an after-school program. They're going to have the health clinics and the supports that the mom needs. If your kid is hyperactive and needs some health care, they're going to have the clinics right there, and everything's in walking distance of the school. Mm-hmm. The community school is going to help the parent and the community support the children staying in school and being able to graduate. Because
so
my
you're basically
issue,
saying go back to where it used to be, community schools. We walk to school. You know, mm-hmm.
No, you're talking neighborhood schools. Mm-hmm.
No, I'm talking about the way I was when I was a kid.
We went
to the school in my neighborhood, right?
Yeah.
We walked to school
illegal.
In the morning. We walked back home for lunch and walked back to school for the afternoon session and walked back home.
The difference between a neighborhood school and the community school is that neighborhood schools were rule segregated because they only allowed the kids in the neighborhood to go. Community school will have all these additional supports, and 20% of the children will come from, they can vote on those schools.
Why do we need segregation? I mean, why do we need integration? Why do we have to, black kids need to.
Because all children need to learn about diversity and respecting other cultures.
But the thing is, of course, integration was just solely put on the backs of black kids because it was mostly black youngsters that had to do the integrating. It was not something that was forced a lot on white kids. White kids still went to neighborhood schools. But it was black kids that was bussed all over the place to do the
early
integrating.
Early on it was the way it was, because I was a part of that program,
So that was reason maybe why.
Later on when they went to magnet schools and things like that, and it was.
A little, but then they created magnet schools to attract white students. It wasn't sort of for black kids. And black kids were still bearing the brunt of integration. That was a whole big problem with busing. They closed every school. If you go back, remember what they did in the African American community. They closed just about every neighborhood school in the black community to force busing on black. They didn't do that to white kids.
This is what we wanted.
White kids still had the opportunity to go to a neighborhood school.
But that's what the whole integration. Thing. That's what we advocated for.
Well, you know,
remember?
I don't think we advocated for that, Frank.
I think it was
integration for a two-way street. I don't think it was that the only people that was going to be integrated or had to do the integration
Let me tell you this. I went to a segregated school. Except my last year, they had forced integration down south. Otherwise, the school would have lost their money. So I went to the local school for integration. I lasted 3 months there. I stayed there 3 months in my senior year, very bright, but was never called on. I'd be in the class the whole day without one teacher calling me. She'll, my hands up for the answer. Mm-hmm. She'll go all around. I was not a person. I sit at the table by myself, set lunch by myself, because I was the only person in that class. I had gone, and after 3 months, I just said, let me go back to my school. I graduated from my segregated school.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but you know, people forget that the reason for integration in the first place. Yeah. Wasn't because there was a belief that black children sitting next to a white child was going to be intelligent by osmosis. Yeah. The reason for integration was that while white children were being bused to schools that had modern equipment and books, black kids were going to schools that didn't even have running water, mm-hmm. and had outdoor toilets. Yeah. And
now, that was
they
in the
didn't
South.
Even, but no, and there was some in the North.
Well,
too,
I mean,
absolutely.
It's de jure integration and segregation.
But I'm saying that was the reason for Brown versus the Board of Education. And that's what the solution, and they experimented, was that's where busing came in. So then now they're going to bus kids. Instead of people fighting to let's improve the schools in our own neighborhood, right. They said, okay, fine, we'll just take you and we're going to send you 10 miles away mm-hmm. to
well,
a school.
Listen, the bottom line, and I've said this before.
The ones that was doing the integrating was all black students.
Well,
the
bottom line is this is the smokescreen that we really wanted. It did more to expand the suburbs than anything you could have possibly done. Because white people fled the cities overnight, and that when you do that, you got to buy more cars, you buy houses, and expanded the suburbs, and which contributed to the economy, and that was the whole scam behind integration. White people didn't just generally move out because
redlined the whole lot,
well, that's redlining black people, but it wasn't redlining the suburbs. The suburbs expanded, and the economy grew. Mm-hmm. You know, that was, to me...
That was the fault of banks who did most of this redlining.
And redlining has nothing to do with the expanding. The banks wanted you to move,
people
to move out.
That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. That was the fault of the bank. They could clean out these neighborhoods and sell these houses. Wouldn't let black people...
No, they weren't cleaning, but you left the city where it was. They expanded the suburbs.
Can we bring it back to the point that 80% of the children in these schools are minority children, and I'm not going to have a two-tiered system where all 80% of our kids are going to schools that are failing. I agree with Joan. We have got to raise the standards.
So you're saying
and
that because they're sending white kids to school, that'll make them a passer?
That these failing schools, they have 10-year-old computers. They're not putting the children don't have books to bring home. They're not putting the best teachers there. I want the schools, I want every child to get a good education, which means we have to raise the funding and the teaching level and the supplies, and the focus has to be on raising these
families.
We want
the better
schools
funded schools
and improving
in the country.
I want to improve
school systems in the country.
I want to improve.
And 75% of that funding goes to teachers.
Frank, do you even understand the matrix and the formula that they use to distribute funds out
so
of
So it's not one of the better funded schools in the country?
No.
Are you saying they're not the
better? The cost per student may be higher.
Right, and 75% of that goes
that
to teachers.
Oh, Frank.
Only 25% really goes to education.
Frank, if you honestly believe that...
Am I wrong with saying 75% of the budget goes to teachers' salary?
I don't know if it does.
Salaries... No, it's a fact.
Salaries and fringe benefits are 55% of the budget, but a significant portion of that is going to retirees.
Listen, I sit up and listen to those school board meetings, and they say, well, let's get a program for, are we going to hire a program to do this or to do that? And if you look at it, it's going to be $1 million for that. 75% that goes to the people that's going to implement it and the teachers. It doesn't go to the kids.
If you don't reduce class sizes and you don't focus on reading and math,
that's just
the
reality.
I'm not knocking it so much.
That's just reality of anything. The labor is always the biggest cost of any business, you know. But
the children can't learn with these 35 in a classroom. The teacher can't give them enough time, develop a relationship with them, can't encourage them. Smaller classrooms.
I don't care how much money you ain't gonna change. I don't care how much money you throw at the problem. It's not about money.
No, it's never been about money.
It's about smaller class sizes.
It's
about pre-K to third grade reading and math to give the children a good foundation so they can succeed. It's about giving the children the opportunity to get a skill, a trade, a vocation, so they can come out and have a reason to go to 12 years of school. They come out with a job, employable. That's why kids are coming,
and
sports.
You could take a horse to water, but you can't make them drink. You can have them give them
all
those programs, but if they don't take it, there's nothing you can do about it.
But nobody seems to be talking about what do you need to solve the problem.
You know what? I'm looking at my two-room school. And sixth when I went to high school. no special ed class, no high school, no high dropout, no suspension.
No teacher's aides.
No teacher's aide.
Just the principal.
Well, the student with teacher's aide, because I was a peer teacher, so I was a teacher's aide. They had the higher grade level teaching the younger one. Very little resource. The kids came out with an education that they could use to go to college and succeed in college. I don't understand what's different. We got better buildings, more money, more specialized teachers, and the children are failing at the rate they are now.
Yeah, exactly.
But you know, you have to take in consideration, it's like the model for community schools. You have to teach to the whole child. And children in urban school districts, and this is not just Buffalo, the same thing's happening in Pittsburgh, Oakland, it's happening across the United States, the same thing is happening. And that is, with white flight, the income base, which is property taxes, was a large percentage of what funded schools. And so when the income base left the city, they allowed the schools to deteriorate, and this has been going on for decades.
Well, Joan, I think you just brought up something here.
We get funded from the state.
If property taxes are the basis of funding for all schools, then shouldn't one of the solutions be to take away property as a funding for schools?
But property taxes is mainly for the suburban school, not the city schools.
Well, maybe it should be taken away for all. If this is the problem, and this is why taxpayers are so resistant to come with money, then maybe what schools need to be funded is perhaps by government and not based on property, on what people own. Because obviously in the city, and as people are not rich or not well off or have a good job, then they don't have the money to pay for schools. I'm saying if the schools' budgets are based on property taxes, then we need to do something about property taxes and not having the schools, not having education, relying on property taxes.
The majority of the funding for the Buffalo schools comes from the state. It does not come from the city of Buffalo. The city of Buffalo has not increased its funding to the schools for the last 8 years, and they are still at $70 million. The county gives $40 million. Mm-hmm. The majority of the money funding our schools is coming from the state. And I think the problem with the children not coming to school, the lack of attendance, the high suspension rates, they're kicking our kids out, and the lack of parent involvement. My father told me school is the key for you not picking those grapes and cutting those grapes and breaking your back. If you want to succeed, get a good education. The children now don't believe getting an education is going to get them a job because they see PhDs out here without a job. So we have to, again, let the parents and the children work together with the schools and say, yes, school is, one, going to get you a job, and two, it's got to be a place where you feel welcome and you don't just study module 1, 2, or 3. Children need art, they need music, and the teachers are complaining that the young men won't sit down, they can't control them. Well, phys ed is a law. The children aren't going to hold their hands. Boys need sports. The coaches was a mentor to the young men. They learn how to do fair, playing by the rules. Sports is important. A whole child, music is important.
All this
is
great, but we still get away from the fact of who's pays it. Even when you talk about state taxpayers, pitch all kinds of hell when taxes go up in county taxpayers. Look how hard it is for our Erie County exec trying, what do they say? We're not going to raise property tax. We're not going to raise property. This is a county. And what is the state big arm? We're not going to raise property tax. We won't raise property. We won't raise tax. Well, this is who funds the school. So we still get down to the point where the basis of funding schools is property. And we still get down to that.
So how should we fund it then?
This is what I'm putting out here now. I think government should fund it.
It's coming from taxes one way or another.
I think it should be.
Unless you go to a charter school.
No, I'm still saying that even when we talk about the government funds it or the state or the county, the money still comes, as they're always saying, every single time when polling cars, when a big argument said, I am not going to raise property taxes. because this is who is funding the school. And it's the same with the state. That's the big argument.
The majority of Erie County money does not come from property taxes.
Well, I'm just saying what they always say.
State money comes from income taxes.
I'm still saying this is what their argument is every election. We're not going to raise property taxes.
The county doesn't matter want to raise property tax in Erie County, but you got all other town villages. But their tax rate is based on their school system. So you might have county tax property increase, but might have, if you live in the village of Sloan or Angola, you might have a property tax increase. Mm-hmm. But that's controlled by their local government.
That's what I'm still saying. This is the biggest complaint that taxpayers have when it comes out to property taxes, And this is a big thing that every politician running gets up there, and the first thing, two things he shout about is, we're going to reduce crime and we're going to reduce property taxes.
Mm-hmm. Or not raise
it. Well, I mean, if property doesn't, who pays for it? I mean,
tax on the rich. That's what Bernie Sanders is talking about.
And I think
get your income taxes. I pay income taxes.
I agree with that.
And that's got to be a revenue source for funding.
The problem is that the matrix that they use to fund public education hasn't changed dramatically in over 100 years. And so they, instead of equality in education, we need equity. And that is distributing the money to the school districts that need it the most. Here we have Amherst crying because they can't get $80,000 for a soccer field. And last year, the kids at I don't know what public school it was, they were at the school board meeting because they couldn't buy musical instruments. I mean,
so we still get that. We still get back down to the same thing. The burden is on taxpayers, and usually those that can least afford it. Bernie Sanders is right when he says if the rich were paying their fair share. We have the Walton family. 16 people didn't make up the Walton family, and those 16 people own just as much about as every worker in Erie County makes or earns. And this is where it comes down. It comes down to who is basically paying for this, and it is people who can probably ill afford it because their taxes are going up all the time. So we still get back down to who is going to pay for it, who is paying for it.
Well, if you don't own property, you ain't paying into the system.
Well, people that do, maybe smaller homeowners.
Bernie Sanders is still right.
Because if the Waltons were paying anywhere near what they're supposed to be paying, and like Donald Trump was busy talking about, I'd get away paying as little tax as I can. He doesn't want to even disclose what his tax rate is because it's so low. His tax rate is probably lower than any of us are paying.
Mm-hmm. Probably 25% or less.
Yeah, probably lower than any of us are paying. If they were forced to pay, the Trumps and the Waltons of this country, we wouldn't have a lot of these problems that we do have with public institutions.
But we will have these children go to prison, and we'll pay $70,000 a year to keep them in prison. Mm-hmm. I think it would be wiser to put more money into the schools so the kids can get a good education and come and reform the schools so the children graduate and come out with a job rather than keep paying for expanding the prison industry.
Then you're going to run up against racism.
You know how many white people was employed by the prison industry?
That's what I'm saying. You're going to run up against racism.
You know, they ain't trying to stop that.
Well, that's because they privatized. The same thing happened is because when they privatized the penal institutions.
In some places.
When they privatized it, like I said before, it's like a hotel. You're not going to make any money if the rooms are vacant.
That's what they want to do, man.
So they see that in that.
But even this is based on a lot of racism. We're a nation of 300 plus million people live in the United States. And if 15% of the total population is African American or Latino, yet we are 80 or 90% of the prison population, how do you get that kind of number? Are black people or people of color born with a criminal gene?
No, it's called the school-to-prison pipeline.
Well, this is what we're talking
they
about.
They suspend our children for little or nothing.
This?
Our African-American men. I'm not down on teachers. There are good teachers. Mm-hmm. But somebody has to take a look at the bad teachers. I have a nephew who is 6'2", and he's a gentle giant. And a teacher said that my nephew pushed him into a locker. and they suspended my nephew. And my nephew cried and said, Mommy, I never touched that teacher. Well, we, of course, respect teachers. We were raised to trust the teachers. And we told them, you don't put your hand on a teacher, you respect the teacher. Well, the security guard came and told us. That was the fourth African-American tall young man that teacher got suspended out of school. And he was standing there, and my nephew never touched the teacher. So we have to do something about teachers who are afraid of our young African men and suspending them and getting them kicked out of school. You know, we need to have teachers who can understand, who have diversity training, who can have innovative methods of teaching so they can reach our kids, and we have to have teachers who love our kids. And I'm not going by race, because I know there are a lot of white and black teachers who love our kids, but the bad teachers who should not be teachers and are just getting a check.
Well, that's the
need
same with the police
out.
Department and any other thing. Mm-hmm. And diversity training is one thing, but when you don't live in a community where you actually know who your neighbor is, and you are coming into a community and you're looking at that community as some sort of subhuman race, then I don't care how much diversity training you may have, these things kick in because you don't see black young men or black young women as equals. You see them as a population that needs to be controlled. And that's all. The same with police, the same with firefighters. Have a nephew that's a firefighter. And he was saying the first thing that they do when they get out of work is hop into their pickup trucks and head to the suburb. They don't really know the population. They have nothing to do with the population. And you can have all kinds of diversity training, but if you have no contact with the people that you teach or the people that you are supposed to protect, this is what you're going to have. And most teachers, like most firefighters and most policemen, have no contact with the communities that they are in. None. And that's the same with teachers who, not all teachers, like you say, I agree with you on that. Not all teachers are this way. But a good majority of them have absolutely no contact with these kids until they come in. And what do they see? They see out of control, disorderly kids. And what do you expect? Well, they black or they're Latino or whatever. And this is what you expect out of them. That's the only contact they have.
I have African-American teachers in my church. They love these kids. And the kids come in kindergarten, and they're calling them four-letter words and telling them, you know, my parent, and F-U-C-K-U, and they don't have home training. We have to have parents who raise their children to respect themselves and teachers who come to school not hungry and not dirty, but ready to learn. I personally am going to suggest that we give parenting classes to the parents. Because
a lot of these parents are probably a little more than kids themselves.
Exactly. We have 12-year-olds having children.
Let me ask you what you
think
of this.
And they're a child.
Let me think of this. Something I wrote about a column about a couple months ago. What do you think about cameras in this classroom?
For what purpose?
To try to see who's
cameras in the classroom.
Right?
So we got cameras everywhere else. When there's an issue, you know, you can rewind the video and see what happened.
Aren't you running into privacy issues?
Well, I don't know. It's cameras every place else we go in society nowadays.
But what would that solve?
It solved a problem recently on the school bus where, I don't know, it might have been reversed, where the mm-hmm. kid was accused of being sexually assaulted, and the mm-hmm. video showed that it
they
wasn't true.
Mm-hmm.
Why not? It's a public setting. Parents can tune in and see their child in the actual setting, with the internet nowadays, and see how their kids are doing in the classroom. The teachers could be monitored to see if they're really teaching.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know what's wrong with that. We got cameras on us every place else in society. There's big brothers here. So why not use it in the classroom?
Because I'm in support of police officers having a camera on their
right,
uniform
exactly.
Yeah, so
exactly.
that they can, we know there's police abuse, and you also know when there's maybe an inmate or somebody mm-hmm. abuse. I think I like the idea.
I just want to move us on just a little bit so we at least touch on it before we go. And
holds everybody accountable misbehavior. It holds the teacher accountable if she's
right,
not
exactly.
in control of the classroom. Mm-hmm. And the child knows he's being monitored. He can't be saying those words to the teacher because his parents will find out about
right.
it.
Well, let's move on to one thing. And I put in here, and I'm just wondering what the panel may think of this. At one time, it was like everyone was a crooked politician was always thought to be a politician out of New Jersey. That's who the crooked politicians were. God, it's in New Jersey. Even in The Wizard of Oz, he was the wizard was out of New Jersey, and he was a crooked wizard, and he was out of New Jersey. Do you know when you pick up a paper and just about every politician you can think of is on his way to jail or just one step ahead of the sheriff? And even here, and we think of politicians, the people call themselves Democrats or whatever, and who kept control of the Senate, who kept control of the Senate in the hands of Republicans? What, two or three Manhattan Democrats?
The independent Republican, Democratic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what, does anyone have any thought about that? And particularly, what was Mr. Pigeon? Mr. Pigeon has been on in the political scene in one way or another for years, and was crooked.
There's been crooked politicians all
along. Well,
it
remains to be seen. He hasn't been convicted of anything yet, or even charged with anything yet.
He's been kind of smart, but it's kind of like everybody sort of knows it.
I'm not saying he's not guilty of anything, but he hasn't been indicted yet, so we can't really.
I like the way you said yet.
Yeah, well, yet. I mean, if there was something really there, he would have probably been indicted by now.
There's always been crooked politicians, and I think because Ms. Pigeon was such a record keeper that he kept every email that he got, and he kept all of his correspondence, that it might be other people going to be involved because him keeping that record. I knew, you know, being a politician.
He covered his tracks, you're saying.
Well, he would just kept her. He never threw anything away. Mm-hmm. And to see the Silvers and the Skettles going to jail, it's surprising he went to jail. It's not surprising that they were not honest politician.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people always have taken money.
You're surprised they actually went to jail. They're actually going to jail.
Absolutely, because a lot of things they're above the law. And, mm-hmm. and I've known instances where people have come to meetings with money in paper bags. You know.
Oh wait a minute. Honestly.
Honestly, yeah.
Okay.
When they're seeking the endorsement and they money changed hands, I'm not calling the names because mm-hmm. I want to be able to get up in the morning. But there, I've always been that element of money exchange of hand.
Is that open? Somebody's come to me with a paper bag with money in it, and this is all in front of me. I mean, there's a group of people sitting there.
It's a small group of people. I'm going into details, but I've seen actually money change hand to secure an endorsement.
Yeah, even if it's only three people in a room.
Well, remember Tammany Hall?
So always the crooked politics always make change of funds unethically and legally. All the problem is that with the computers and with internet and with secret recordings, you know, people are being caught for it. That's why I think it's critical we have campaign finance reform.
Mm-hmm,
that there be a certain amount of money that you can spend in an election. Nobody should be able to spend $3 or $4 million on a job that pays $59,000 a year. I mean, why are you spending so much money for a position that's going to pay you one-fifth of what you spend to get that position?
Mm-hmm.
The people who are supporting you want something from you once you get elected.
What I find interesting is that you see the politicians going to jail now. How often do you see the actual bribers going to jail? You know, or getting, that's the thing that's puzzling to me. Yeah.
Yeah. But if you look at who's gone to jail in the last 15 years, most of them have been from downstate, from New York City area.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of them have been a person of color. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know whether they are being cut, scrutinized more.
We're just easy bait. We're just easy to get, you know.
Well, there's also some crooked people of color, too.
Well, I'm just saying that a lot of them are going to jail downstate who've been people of color, and I think maybe they were either scrutinized more than the other politician or they just got careless. I'm not sure.
Well, that's why, you know, November the 7th, 2017, on the ballot, once every 20 years, New Yorkers get an opportunity to vote on whether we want a constitutional convention or not. And one of the amendments that we need, other than doing away with closed primaries, is reforming. Yeah, absolutely.
Right.
And there are people now that are forming. I went to a meeting out at UB Law School. There are people, groups forming now that don't want a constitutional convention because once they think it's gonna affect their pensions, two, because they want to maintain, close the loopholes for LLCs, for example.
Right.
So, but there's a group that's forming now to roll out a campaign so that when people, you know, more people didn't mark that spot on the ballot, mm-hmm. more that it just ignored it, then voted yes or no, because you know it's like on what page two or something. But they're going now and doing a very good job of rolling out public information, mm-hmm. so that we can, because the legislature's not going to do it.
Right. No, they're not.
They're not going to do mm-hmm. it.
You know, something else has wondered why so many people on a national level, why Donald Trump, I don't think really has Teflon, as I think he kind of knows that he will say things and get away with it. When he started calling George Bush, you know, kind of like, what do you call George Bush?
Low energy
Bush, and they didn't kind of like fight back. And I had a little piece that, in fact, I did on radio, and he said, you know, what people didn't do, and Donald Trump is probably fully aware of this, they let him get away with things, saying, and they don't fight back, saying, oh, he's just silly or he's whatever. And he gets away with it because they don't know how to win. Does anybody kind of agree?
Well, you know what, he's been saying all these things, and people were ignoring him. Then when they started to fight back, like Marco Rubio, he got eliminated.
It's kind of late when he started to fight back.
Yeah, Ted Cruz, when he fought back, got more or less eliminated. So I think Donald Trump is tapping to a demographic that's tired, that has had 8 years of an African-American president. They feel that with the influx of the Hispanics, that they're going to lose their majority status
That's
in
the
America.
Word that you wanted
so
to say that was really,
they're
really
angry,
good.
And they're coming to the polls in record numbers. And I wouldn't be surprised if in November a lot of dissatisfied Democrats from the South who have not changed affiliation will be voting for the Republicans in this election.
Let me say this, to win against Donald Trump, you have to not be afraid to lose, to win against him. So like when you said the word lose, this is it. Maybe you have to not be afraid to lose. Say, well, yeah, I'm going to lose this, but I'm still going to say this about you.
Mm-hmm. Well, his mantra is keep America great. It's really keep America white. I mean, make America white again.
You.
That's what his underlying mantra is, you know.
Right.
But to call Donald Trump a racist and all that, that only plays into his face,
whatever
you know.
Saying. He said, you tell yourself, if I'm going over a cliff, I'm going to grab you by the neck and take you with me. And maybe that's what those people did not do with Donald Trump. So
well,
if
he can
I'm
say
going
those things because he's a billionaire. He's not beholden to anybody. He knows it. You know, that's
oh,
what
he's beholden, or he's a crook of first class. And I can imagine if the boy doesn't want to show his tax return, and as he's finding out right now, I think that one reason why maybe Bernie would be a better opponent for him, because I don't think Bernie's afraid to lose. I think Bernie has got another cause that he's basically fighting for and saying, well, if I'm going over this cliff, I'm going to take you with me.
I think Bernie probably started not wanting, expecting to win or be as well as a deal, but maybe to change the policy that's mm-hmm. coming forward for Hillary Clinton. He has done that. He has vetted her, and I think that had not been competitive on these different primaries and caucuses, I think he would be unprepared to face Donald Trump in November.
Mm-hmm.
Because what the question that Bernie's put to her, she's got 7 months to get a credible answer to these questions.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think he's bringing out things. He's the better. He's really toughening her up for the elections coming here.
He's pushed the whole country to the left. He's even pushed the Republicans to the left.
Well,
because he made them start thinking about things that they never really thought about.
But
most Americans never thought about.
Let me tell you something. Here's another scenario. Mm-hmm. Chris Collins was on TV a couple of days ago saying that Donald has narrowed his selection down to five people, and they said, well, who you want? He said, well, for me, for first, second, third place, I want Condoleezza Rice. And he's already said that. Now, what if mm-hmm. Donald Trump chooses Condoleezza Rice?
Oh, God.
Well, Condoleezza had got baggage, too.
I would be a bit surprised.
Oh,
I wouldn't be surprised.
To be very careful. They have to be very careful who the vice presidential was.
Because mm-hmm. she's got the conservative credibility.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
right, right. And and also,
and
they're going to impeach him. If he wins,
he's
going to get impeached. There's no doubt about it, because the mm-hmm. Republicans want to get back in power.
Mm-hmm.
So whoever his vice presidential candidate, we got to pay a lot of attention, because they plan to either assassinate him or impeach him, you know, as soon as he gets in.
And she was very loyal to President Bush. Wasn't
right,
she?
Yeah, yeah, mm-hmm. yeah.
She was very loyal. So
exactly.
And it didn't do Bush all that good either,
I
did
hadn't thought about that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Even I didn't
even
think
he
brought
it right.
The first time he starts talking about deporting people and all these illegal acts, they're going to impeach him. And they know that, you know. This I hear there's a committee already that's been discussing this. what would happen if he wins, you know. So his vice presidential candidate has got to pay close attention.
And Chris Collins, I always say she'll be the first female president.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's true. She will be the first female. Yeah.
You're talking about Condoleezza Rice. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, it seems to me as
though... she's a minority, right?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Right, yeah.
Did anybody ever hear Donald Trump on the Howard Stern show? You ever tune in to Howard Stern?
I don't want to listen to Howard. Not my favorite person.
You should have heard. I listened to some excerpts from it a few days ago, and they were talking about some of the things that... See, Donald has forgotten he said these things, that he was on Howard Trump, on Howard Stern show, and he forgot about all these things he said, particularly about women. He was in there talking about his wife's bosom. This is Donald now, you know.
She's got the best breast.
He was talking about all these different, he was sizing up going like from who was a number one up to who was a number 10. Talked about Halle Berry.
Oh, Halle.
So she's a 10 from the top down.
Yeah,
from the shoulders down, she's a 10.
10, yeah. He went through and he was telling all these secrets about women who, we talk about kiss and tell. My God, I mean, the man has no honor whatsoever, you know.
Yeah, but he used to say he could shoot somebody on Fifth Avenue and they'd still vote for him at this point.
Yeah, the way he was talking out these women, it was beyond belief when they were talking about them on the Howard Stern show. And who had the biggest bosom, who didn't, and who had the whatever else down in between your legs and who didn't. Yeah, you know, it was just amazing. Well, yeah, this man is talking like this.
When they had his wife, they interviewed his wife, and she said, it's about immigration. She said, well, of course he's for immigration because who Americans don't want to, who else would clean our rooms? Americans don't want to do it. And I thought, oh, great. So that's the last comment they got from her.
and this issue you got to hear about is Butler. Is the virile racism of his
Butler.
You don't surround your people, yourself with people.
This man is talking about hanging.
Yes,
he did. He said he wanted to hang Barack Obama from the porch of the White House.
Oh, yeah.
And he didn't call it white as anymore. He said it was the white mouse.
I think Trump condemned that quickly, too, didn't he?
He probably did, yeah. He said he hadn't worked for him in a while.
The man had worked for him for, like, 20 years, so he must have knew some of what his feelings were. He'd been working for him for 20 years. You know, and then all these other races that, oh, no, see, he won't say this, but who's this one, this Ku Klux Klan person? Who
David
endorsed
Duke.
It? David Duke was one, and there was another one. He said, "Well, he it can't own us, but we're gonna, you know, endorse him." I'm saying, "Oh my goodness!"
And he's still winning primaries after primaries.
Well, folks, we're down to our last 2 minutes here, and I want to give you each something to sum up on something we may have touched on. What do you think we didn't touch on? You want to bring up?
Well, me, I just want to say thank you to say yes. I went to two of my schools, and KeyBank gave $1 million toward the education of Buffalo School kids. I want to say thank you for working to educate our kids. That's important to me.
Oh, that's very good. Anybody else must have something we didn't touch on?
Just an announcement again. The United States Department of Education Office for Civil Rights has agreed to conduct an information education session on June 9th, 5:30 to 7:30 at McKinley High School. And I encourage all parents, students, concerned citizens, organizations, and groups to attend to get the information firsthand on the role and responsibilities of the Office of Civil Rights.
And we only got 1 minute, and Betty Jean and Frank haven't said anything. Well, what do you want to leave us with?
I just want to let the community know that on Wednesday, May 18th, we Women Warriors will have a forum at the Meriwether Library called Ask a Police Officer. As you know, sometimes our youth, they become mouthy, and instead of being quiet, they might say something that will escalate a simple situation to something that will be a crisis. So we're asking parents come out and bring their young children, especially teenage sons and daughters, about what to do if you stop by the police, because we don't want to have any of our children arrested or fortunately killed like they are in other cities.
Frank, you got
anything? No, nothing. Just congratulations to Paulette again on her election.
For her election.
Yeah. I just want everybody to know Dr. Nash passed He's Phoenicia's College, and his funeral is at St. Philip's Church on Tuesday. Mm-hmm. He was one of my mentors. We're losing a lot of our great leaders.
And we need to wind up. And I'm your host, Mary Davis. I'm glad you tuned us in. I thought this was a very interesting and enlightening panel we had today, and I think we learned a lot. We covered a lot of ground. And to stay tuned throughout your evening. And be sure to catch the Mary Davis Show on AM 1400 Solid Gold Soul, as well as on WGR AM 550. Thank you all to my guests, and good night.
You gotta get it.